So what has changed is this, right? So if you see in terms of scale, so these are some numbers which marketing created from our 2018 Big Billion Day sales. To give you an idea of the volume, so we sold 1 million phones in an hour. Today, pretty much all of these remain the same. And along the way, we also started dealing with saying, okay, can we do, in terms of patterns, we adopted CQRS, command and query responsibility separation. We started different consistency levels, right? So today, for example, if you're looking for an item, the availability of an item, if you're browsing through catalog pages versus when you get to the actual product page where you're going to buy, there's can potential for a difference in availability, right? That's because what's coming in your browse pages, we know it's slightly lower intent. So rather than serve from a single consistent store, we kind of serve it from a eventually consistent store. Right now, so that sort of happened, and also from an architectural paradigm shift, we moved to microservices, as you may, right? Each one of these bits of information that you see highlighted there comes from its own unique service, right? So catalog is separate, pricing is separate, the ratings and reviews, sellers, and so on. So there's essentially to render a single page. Now what has happened is we have a huge fan out that going into a whole bunch of backend services. Now, what can be the problem with that? So I shouldn't be in a presentation mode. So I was talking about those bits of information, right? So they're coming from different services. So what we had with this was essentially we had the probability of failures essentially became more, right? So if you see overall availability, this starts to reduce as your number of services go up, right? So, I think say in 2012, we used to have instances where there is alarm on the floor saying site is degraded, everybody rushes, and you see a blank page. You hit www.flipkart.com and you see a blank page, right? So it is either complete site-wide outage, and that could be attributed to because some resources on, we were using CouchDB. So CouchDB were locked up and all PHP processes got exhausted, and therefore the whole site went blank. Now, when we went to this kind of model, obviously with more numbers of services, it's quite possible that more instances can lock up and you can start having failures, right? So from there, we moved to essentially this making a case for circuit breakers. So if you have used circuit breakers, you'll know what this is. So we kind of came to deal with the fact that it's okay to probably have partial failures rather than have a complete site-wide failure. But how do you then isolate and separate yourself from these kind of partial failures? So even during our PHP days, there was from an architectural pattern, so we had introduced what is now popularly called a sidecar, right? So it's a process running on the same box, which is doing a different functionality. And the first ever sidecar, even before 2012, we had was, while we were using PHP, we had a local Java process which was acting as a sidecar for all the connection management to the backend DB, loading configurations, and so on. Because PHP being an interpreted process was going to make a DB connection call for every single request that started. So we had started to operate sidecars very early on. And then when we started looking at, okay, if you want to introduce this circuit breaker as a pattern, what is the right way to do? So we introduced a local proxy, which we wrote, which could talk HTTP, which could talk Thrift, and that became a transparent layer between our PHP process and all upstream services, right? So we open sourced that as well. We called it Phantom because it's just invisible. And that then helped to isolate a lot of these failures. And I think this deck is a little later, but we were like running literally of hundreds of millions of calls through this proxy. And we were in a state where you would never probably see an entire www.flipkart.com going down, but you can have partial failures that occur, right? And if you see the product page example that I was telling you, we came to realize that, look, on a flash sale, if you're trying to buy something, right, you know, flash sale where there's high intent traffic, it's okay if you don't show a rating and review, but so long as you can show the price and the buy now button, and even if you don't sell a rating, it's still okay, but you can. So therefore, we started saying, okay, these optional bits of data in the whole call graph of a service, it's okay if that were to fail, but so long as the mandatory calls return, you still render the page for the customer, right? So we formalized that kind of in a pattern, and again, that was called another container which we had called Poseidon. So which means it could do fan out and do optional and mandatory calls, and again backed by your circuit breaker. So you could do whole lot of isolation with that, right? And that pattern also I think is quite common. Like if you go maybe to your Facebook page, right, you will probably see whole lot of information, maybe friend status, even if that's not showing, if so long as your timeline is showing up, it's still for you, it's a, you know, it's a successful rendering of your homepage or timeline, right? So we started going down that path, and while with polyglot persistence, so this kind of became an intermediate layer in between. Fast forward somewhere, we had a whole bunch of, don't read through all of this, it's just there, but it basically says that when we started our architecture and capabilities started to grow, we started having mechanisms for doing data collection for our analytics. We started having mechanism for doing better configuration management, right? So we started having auditing systems for debugging the API. So all of these got integrated into a very opinionated container, which was again closed source. Why? Because it was very specific to our infrastructure that we were hosting, right? So if you see Foxtrot, while it is still an open source project, but we were running local instances. So Spectre is our daemon, which is used for pushing. So if you know, I think Facebook or one of these guys had something called Flume, right? If you know Flume for pushing data to Hadoop kind of sinks. So we have similar daemons. So all of these were kind of integrated and made available in a single container, which is, let's say in the Java world, Drop Wizard plus, which teams could adopt, right? And we had a variant of that on running on top of Netty as well. And largely our stack kind of evolved around the JVM because of a lot of tooling support, language, confidence, the scale, the kind of libraries that were available and so on. So essentially that's how the stack grew. Now in terms of, okay, your scale, you probably are doing, right, so a few million requests per second and so on, then what can be other dimensions to consider in scaling? Primary for us is both an opportunity and a problem we created for ourselves, that was the flash sales, right? So when we did the first flash sale, 2014, I think, the sale opened and 2 minutes later, there was a hush in the room because the inventory count showed as zero. Right, so we didn't know whether things were okay, whether there was a failure. That was the first MI phone was getting launched in India. And that's when we realized that actually we could sell out 50,000 phones in 3 seconds, right? But that creates a very different problem, which is about very spikiness in traffic, right? And this spikiness in traffic, the problem with that is, contrary to what I've heard or I believe, is you just cannot scale stateful systems to that kind of scale on demand. There's no elasticity there, right? So which kind of means that now our infrastructure has to always be provisioned for that spike, and that remains as your capacity that you're committing. And unlike public clouds, now for the footprint that we carry, it was very, very hard, and I'll talk about that journey as well when we built our own private cloud. You can't just scale up and down on demand from public clouds, right? They're asking for, okay, with this kind of capacity, you need a 3-year commitment for provisioning of resources. So which means you just can't scale down on demand. Now, it also creates another problem, is we started saying that not all services in this whole call graph scale equally, right? So there will be limits that you will hit for every service. Right, every service will do a certain QPS, right? And the QPS can be from 10K, 100K, 500K, 250K QPS per second, and then they will still max out. So what do you do when they start maxing out? So we wanted to introduce throttling and back pressure, right? So that got added, where every service could throw up its hands after a certain amount of QPS, what it commits, and then says, beyond this, I can't serve any more traffic. Then it really became the decision of the callee systems to decide what to do as a behavior, right? Then we started isolating clusters, right? It is always better to have better serviceability to higher intent traffic, as in someone who is deeper into the conversion funnel than someone who is just window shopping, right? So we started separating that. we started differentiating data consistency, right? If you're browsing, maybe we show you data that is slightly stale versus if you're adding an item to the cart. Then we had another problem, which is we created this demand and people also started being creative. There were plugins that got created, right? The Buy Hard K plugins. Some kid in college saw that we are sending HTTP traffic, so they wrote JavaScript to just hit our endpoint because it's coming over. You can still figure out what we're trying to do. So this, when I told you that we throttle, so when we throttle, now we are serving all traffic, right? Whether it is such plugin generated traffic, whether it is such bot generated traffic and genuine traffic. Now, we had instances where 2/3 of our traffic were coming from such bots. So which means during a flash sale, forget a flash sale user not being able to buy a phone. Let's say a parent will not be able to buy a baby diaper from Flipkart because it's all basically the same backend checkout systems which are starting to throttle, right? They're throttling. I mean, they're not degrading, but they're throttling. So you start seeing that site is busy and why? Because we're serving bot. So we started with multiple solutions. So now we have steady state, we have bot detection that runs 24/7 on our clusters, trying to actually try to differentiate between what is human versus what is non-human bot-like traffic, right? And there is no way where we could just have kept scaling higher and higher. We started with initially thinking that it was genuine traffic, but then we realized that, look, this is bot as against, and this is not, when I say bot, it's not DDoS kind of bots. These are, you know, I wouldn't say these are, yeah, these are like naive users who are running some script. And when we did IP filtering, we see the ones we saw that there was a whole lot of traffic coming from some university in Punjab. Maybe some kids trying to buy and sell the phones in the offline market or whatever, right? So again, so the takeaway was we had to throttle and also try to differentiate between what is good traffic to serve versus what is not worth serving. So on linear scalability, right? So with, we all know that with distributed systems, yes, you can linearly scale arguably by deploying more hardware in your app layer, more hardware in your data layer and data store layer, I mean, to certain limits. But what also becomes a challenge is what is the footprint that you're growing to? To give you some perspective, in 2012, we were running our entire web array on like a dozen bare metal boxes. Today, just the web array is around 1,000 VMs, right? Our search cluster runs on about 1,200 VMs and so on. So clearly, there is a cost angle to deploying this large infrastructure, and that's also why public clouds, again, weren't you know, very viable for us from a cost perspective. So 2015, we built our first data center, which was, I think it was a bold thing, and which was in a way forced after our 2014 event. So do you know our first Big Billion Day? Anybody here? Okay. What was the experience? Shameful, right? Right? Okay. But we were so bad and crashing and burning, we just couldn't even SSH into our boxes, right? So network was flooded. We were like just sitting ducks. We, you know, there we just saw traffic. And in our defense, the traffic that came overnight, literally overnight, was tonight was the day before BBD, and the next day it was 25x. Right? And we were nowhere, you know, even prepared to handle 25x kind of traffic. And that's when we realized that even we were choking on our hardware, you know, on our switches, on our servers, on the intra DC network and whatnot. So 2015 we took a bold decision saying we will build our own data center. And the new data center we built there, we did a bunch of things. So we said we will go with a software-defined network. We will define you know, our own instance types. We will start having IaaS API for instance provisioning. We'll start having PaaS services and so on, right? Now, as of 2019, where this has grown to is the latest data center which we opened in Hyderabad, we don't even use commercial off-the-shelf servers, right? So we don't buy from Dell. We buy directly from suppliers in China where it is custom-made for us so that we can optimize on cost, and that works out like overall 40% cheaper, right? So even the, going back to the load balancer, in the network today, between any VM to any other hundreds of thousands of VMs in the data center, there is a committed 5 Gbps or 10 Gbps network connectivity. right? And that came through you know, a custom built out of SDN. And what you see here is essentially our own live console of you know, traffic coming through our soft through our SDN. Hello. Check. Yeah. So what we also realized was, hey, we could have even isolated failures which are specific to an ISP, right? So along the way, we also try to figure what bandwidth, and this is before Jio became popular, okay, just so that you know. And you know, progressive web apps, so all this came in the generation before Jio. So we had to also measure what kind of bandwidth end user was coming from, what kind of ISPs were you know, offering lower bandwidth, where were they terminating, and so on. So today we have controls with which we can measure traffic that is coming from across India, right now across India, because that's our focus. So all of this part of the FCP, or our cloud platform. Now, in order to reduce the cost of linear scaling, the point I was mentioning, right? So we are heavily service oriented. So services were typically, you know, your RESTful services, which are sending JSON payloads over HTTP. And those of most of you developers will realize here that many a time the amount of data that is flowing between your services is quite big, and only a minuscule part of it actually shows up to the end user, right? Like, you want to just show a title of a product, but what you get is big JSON payload which says this is the model, this is the make, this is blah, blah, blah. Now, we did solve for it, where catalog for us still gives us the concept of views, where you can take a full data entity and create multiple views of it, and you can consume the view that you prefer to see. But still, what we realized was we are spending almost 50 to 60% CPU on data marshalling and unmarshalling of those JSON payloads which are coming over HTTP, right? So, and this makes a difference for some of the largest, like our catalog service at peak would do like 3 to 5 million requests per second, right? Because if you're showing even one single product page, the number of product catalog calls behind that could be in the order of tens, if not hundreds of calls, right? Because you're showing variants, you're showing other products, you're showing recommendations. All of these query the catalog, and none of it is materialized in the storefront, right? Because if you materialize in the storefront, then you made storefront, which was essentially just a front-end service, you made it stateful, it has to cache data, and we have had anti-patterns where we did that too, right? So we, in the PHP days, we had a cache in the front. Now, over time, people started relying from the backend systems onto the front-end cache for even querying data, right? So it became a whole very, very vicious circle of trying to chase the whole data consistency and scale. So we made the decision that any bit of data which has to be served by a system will come from the source of truth, and that service would have to scale to whatever be the ask coming in from, you know, its clients. So with that, what happens is our catalog service now has to scale to 5 million requests per second, right? Now, at this, if you're processing so much of data over the, you know, you're burning so much of CPU doing wasteful data marshalling and unmarshalling. So as of this year, we have moved a bunch of our services to gRPC. So essentially, with, you know, protobuf as a binary protocol, right, going over HTTP2. And what we see is that this kind of given us around 30 to 40% reduction in essentially reducing our cost of scaling, but still retaining most of the elements that we created for our, you know, our private cloud, which is we had our own ELB, which talks right now talks only HTTP 1.1, but gRPC is on HTTP2, so we integrated with Envoy and built some containers to essentially give the drop wizard plus plus kind of behavior for easy portability of our apps from, you know, REST to gRPC. So that's, again, it's open sourced, and that's how we work. So a note on how we open source. So we have two orgs. One is Flipkart and Flipkart Incubator. Now, Incubator is an org where any engineer in Flipkart can decide to just create a project, right? So there's like, think of Apache undergoing incubation in principle, but not really so detailed. So any project is actually created there. And once it sees substantial deployment in Flipkart production system, then it graduates into the Flipkart org, right? And And code deployed on our production servers is actually built right off these repositories. So if you take JGX or whatever, what is running right in production is actually built off this repo. So there's nothing like an internal fork of the same repo or any such thing. So it helps us keep it relevant and all commits go in there. So note about resilience, right? So while all this was giving us scale, we can say, okay, we can do 5 million QPS and so on. There were some elements that started to play out, which was in the first hour of sale that I said we did, sold 1 million phones and, GMV, I won't quote numbers, was very high. Now, what in the meanwhile, our analytics systems had started to do was they had started to kind of project traffic and revenues by the hour and sometimes even by order of minutes, right? So what becomes equally important is not, so category is not happy if you, let's say you hit very high QPS, they say that all your offers have to go live at the stroke of midnight, has to show the right price, and there should be zero delays. And if, imagine the first 15 minutes we call out that we're going to sell iPhone dirt cheap or whatever price, and the offer doesn't show up, then they say customers are going away and so on. Now what this means is you're trying to build one is scale, and you're also trying to build a lot of correctness into the system, right? So correctness being how do you ensure that things happen in a timely manner? And timely manner and offline compute and eventually consistent systems essentially don't go together, right? You can never build timeline guarantees to an eventually consistent system, right? Can any of us say that, oh, this MySQL slave would have caught up with master within this time? There's no way of doing that. You can probably at best say, of course you can say that, look, it will catch up, right? So on resilience, so it's again a whole journey. It started with differentiating user intent, throttling, so that you try to give the most significant transactions the right kind of attention, right? We did bot handling, part of it is done, part of it is in progress. What we measure ourselves a lot is on lower mean time to recovery than saying no failures, because that's kind of impossible. Deployments happening through the day, multiple number of times across all the services. So it's saying it's okay to fail, but how soon can you essentially recover, right? Degraded modes, I spoke about that, so that you can still get the most relevant transactions through. Smart retries, again, with the introduction of circuit breakers, what we did was we failed very fast, right? Any latent service, we immediately failed the request. But it's quite possible that request was failing on a particular node because GC was running on that node, right? So can you do some smart retries where the same request can possibly succeed on another node, right? So we are now trying to look at those kind of patterns as well. The next one I'll talk about also is on multi-home services, right? So we operate out of, while we say multiple data centers, we don't have services that can be served simultaneously across multiple data centers. Because that brings a whole lot of data, again, data consistency challenges, right? An example would be, let's say you log into one DC, you change the password, the DC completely gets wiped out, we redirect you to another DC. Do you log in with your new password or the old password? Right, so these kind of challenges. So I'll talk a little more in detail on what we're doing for that. So we're trying to get to active multi-home services. And some more on enhanced observability and early warning systems and so on. So in this journey, this is the second part to say that, okay, we're in order to scale to whatever numbers, right, and the fact that we were not on a public cloud, and again, for various, historic reasons, we couldn't have gone to a competitor's offering. We didn't have anything in India that was available in 2015, right? And so therefore, we ended up building a private cloud. So, and therefore, a whole lot of things that today you take for granted on a public cloud was not available, right? Right from instant provisioning those days where we send emails and communications to a ops team, which then provisions nodes and then makes it available. Now imagine doing that to our hundreds of thousands of machines, just not possible, right? So we had to have instance provisioning where you do VM packing on bare metals, most optimal usage, right? Racks where you can give isolation around saying, okay, running a MySQL cluster, you don't want all of them on the same rack. Right, so you want distribution across racks so that you even in terms of a power failure, you can still separate. So all of that got done. with along maintenance to say that if you shut down a bare metal, how do you move VMs out of that into other areas and teams can provision? The ELB or the elastic load balancer that I was talking about. Metrics, alerting, multiple instance types, right? So storage will have various class, right? Can you get can you get storage with very large disk, like your Hadoop and Kafka kind of nodes versus your HBase and MySQL kind of nodes? So they're running with spinning disk versus SSDs, and again, different class of SSDs. So bunch of those. Deployment service, so that's an interesting thing where how do you deploy a single image for a service across, let's say, thousands of machines, right? Now, you cannot have a mechanism where it's all bottlenecking on IO of a single machine from where all this entire image is getting read, right? So we have like kind of two solutions. So one is where these bits or these images get replicated, one each for each rack. At a rack level, there is a replication. And I also know that we were also working on a BitTorrent-based mechanism where clients can then do a P2P sync and therefore enable you to deploy to hundreds of machines in a matter of a few seconds, right? Again, containerization and VPCs when we try to isolate our payment and other systems. PaaS services, again, generic ones where we have metrics, which is based on OpenTSDB configuration, which is interesting thing here. It is, while it is Zookeeper based, but it also allows you to push configuration changes across thousands of machines. Now, those of you who work with Zookeeper, right, we know that, or etcd or any of these things, you know that you can have listeners, but can you have listeners across thousands of machines? That's not going to work, right? So we have a mechanism where we use the listeners only for a bunch of connected nodes, and then we have our own HTTP based long polling and push mechanism to thousands of nodes. And this is very useful where you're trying to push a configuration change which can be dynamically reflected on number of machines in, you know, in a matter of few seconds. Right, so we have that. We have our own S3 equivalent built on top of Ceph, hosted MySQL, authorization, authentication, logging, and distributed tracing, and so on. So this is like typical stuff that you would see in a public cloud, but the point is, right, we have to build a ton of these things on our own. The Flipkart data platform. Now, this is, again, this can become a talk by itself, so let me just touch on this and you can talk. So this is like, we ingest about more than 3 billion events per day, right? And that's where, if you see the data growth, if you see 80% of the data is less than 2 years old, so which means the rate at which it is growing. And almost 500,000 container hours worth of compute runs every single day, right? So typical of other systems, so you have transactional, you have humans, you have machines from where you're ingesting data. These get processed in both batch and stream, and then there are reports and dashboards which are consumed by the business for decision making, analysis, insights, and so on. Now, this system, again, built, if you see, it is built on, very short, it's built on Hadoop and friends, right? So it's Hadoop, MapReduce, Hive, custom MR, it has, now we are starting to run Spark workloads for streaming. We have built a system called F-Stream, which allows to do much enhanced streaming capabilities. What we also saw was this was one hosted platform, and at any point in time, the cluster is always over-provisioned because people are trying to run queries and they're running out of resources. So we then had to create isolation where everybody gets quotas on how much you can run as batch and streaming compute on top of that, right? And simple thing is, there is this data intern who goes and runs an expensive query during BBD, tries to download the entire catalog, and you have the executive sitting in a control tower during BBD, and their real-time dashboard just goes blank, right? So a lot of isolation had to be built, where, again, and the other problem is with a very large org, people are trying to recompute the same facts again and again and again. Everybody wants monthly facts, right? And that just runs multiple times through the day. So we built dependency lineage into it. So you can identify these facts and you can kind of define a DAG saying, okay, the output of this fact goes into another computed fact and so on. And you just define the fact, the system figures out and runs it only once. And once that is done, you can latch on to execution and then run the others and so on, right? Schema is another problem where you know, those of us who work with these would know, right? It's classic case of, I have a loosely typed transactional system, but then it screws up all the analytics data that comes into the pipeline. You can get a payment information only if the order information is through. Otherwise, just payment by itself doesn't mean much sense, right? So it doesn't allow you to complete the transactions. So, and then we have our whole ML platform layered on top of this. ML, again, it's fairly big, but what we have also seen is that data sciences has become so very mainstream in Flipkart. Pretty much, I can't think of any single system that doesn't use data science today, right? Right from your search query, right? Thanks to Google, that one little search box became an input for NLP, NLU-based expression of interest, right? It can say Kala Juta under 400, right? It's fair, yeah. I mean, users type that, or they can say Saris under 500. So all of this, if you say in terms of intent recognition, natural language understanding, so all that right from search, right from the time you sign up as a user to Flipkart, you place an order, you search for something, you return an item, we have machine learning and data science which runs throughout, right? And these also enable to create scale of a different kind. Like if you return an item, how do we know whether to approve your return? So that is based on, again, machine learning. We can kind of figure the gender of a person from his or her shopping behavior. So if you have to show on the homepage, now if you look at that single homepage, which looks very simple, right? It is various things competing for space there, which is we have ads, we have recommendations, we have personalized content. Now, how do I know whether to show you Bosch Power Tools ad versus a home, let's say home improvement ad, right? If I know the gender, maybe I can take a call. So all of this is computed using ML platforms, and this runs on top of all the data that is gained, right? You can even figure out like the number of children in your household and their gender without you kind of telling us anything. We don't sell that, but. Yeah, so this again, PaaS service, which exists as a, you know, as a generic thing, and is important for us to, you know, as part of scaling. The reason I say scale is, as engineers, when we think scale of only like, okay, how many QPS it can do, what volume of transactions. But what is also important is, we sell, let's say, a few million products, right? Now, how do I know what to price this product at? Of course, you can say that, okay, you employ a whole bunch of people who are looking at, you know, our competitor websites, looking at customer past behavior, and say we should price it at this particular product, right? But today, most of our pricing decisions is actually automated. And part of it came from a company that we acquired in Israel. And most of our products that you see priced on Flipkart comes from these, you know, machine learned models. So that's also, I think, part of, you know, the whole scaling to see how you can remove human element from it. Another one was workflows, right? So if you see workflows for us, once an order is placed, everything after that is a workflow, right? And we have multiple workflow systems, like any company. Every engineer likes to build his own, and I'm sure there are a few of us here who has built a workflow system, right? Airflow is there, but I don't like it. Activity is there, yeah, but I don't like it. So we looked at it, we built a workflow system. This actually came later. There's another system which precedes this, which basically allows you to express any async interaction in a state machine and in an evented model. It's just that it makes it stateful, right? Think of AWS Lambda functions and activity flows. It's something equivalent of that, right? So you don't have to deploy compute, you deploy code. And the code is essentially, you know, you can do very complex fork joins and stuff without, there's no DSL outside of the code. So you write the code, the engine parses it, figures out that, you know, in this case, these nodes can be executed concurrently, would execute them concurrently. It says, okay, this now requires a join. It would figure that it needs to do a join and complete it, right? So this, again, something we open sourced and, again, an infrastructure piece that exists. Yeah, so while Flux does exist, most of our supply chain runs on this model, which is about we starting with the whole service-oriented way. So we said every unique piece of functionality in the fulfillment is modeled as a REST service. Fair. So you get abstraction. You get each team can move on its on its own. But the problem with this is, unlike a user interaction where something fails, you can always come back and saying, "Oops, something went wrong," right? And you fail the interaction. In a stateful orchestration, you cannot have a failed interaction, right? So essentially, now what you're trying to do is you're trying to ensure that the write to the first DB, the write to the next DB, and so on is now within one transactional scope, right? And that then talks about saying you need to have distributed transactions and so on, in order to make this whole thing simply reliable, right? So yeah, this is what it was trying to say. So if you're separating each of those by a queue, and that's a very common pattern, right? You're trying to shield, buffer the messages going into the next stage. Then what you need is, even in the first instance, you're talking about the first operation has to be a one transactional scope, right? Now there are XA transactions, but if you worked with messaging and DB, you know that how hard or how much of an anti-pattern it is. So the way we solved, I mean, a little complex, but I will just walk you through it. So essentially what we built was something called, we call it as a REST bus, which is both your data which is relevant for that application and the data that has to be relayed is written to the same DB within the same transaction scope. And then we have an offline relayer which is reading the data which is to be relayed and sends it through the queue to the next service, right? So that way the data which is core to the app and thing that has to be relayed is persisted and nothing is lost. So this system, and it has got complex that even the messaging layer offers a lot of guarantees around retries, exponential backoffs, and so on. So that system that we call it as REST bus is now pretty much powers a significant portion of all our offline supply chain, right? And that is like to give you a number, like today we, on any day, we would be shipping out 1 million products from our warehouse, which means 1 million products reaching end customers. So this is something that has to orchestrate, and if each order has 10 steps, if you're talking about 10 million orchestrations happening every single day, right? And that kind of goes through this generic platform. Now the last part, I think the data store revolution, I think, is the more interesting in this. So I was talking about MySQL scaling as a challenge, right? So the way we tried to scale it was we said, okay, let's go to tiered data stores where each tier would be able to serve a particular need. So if you look at our orders database, you can say, okay, live orders, MySQL, great. After it moves into, when you're trying to do payment reconciliation, can it move to a warm store? And post order fulfillment, can it really go into a cold store, right? So we kind of built change propagation, and that's when we introduced this whole concept of saying, okay, otherwise, normally what you would do is if you're populating a cache, you're populating a DB, you would probably have the application write to both places. Common pattern, right? So you write to both. But the problem you'll have with that is, okay, write to the cache succeeded, write to the DB failed, you have all of these reconciliation problems. So we chanced about saying, why don't we now tap into the replication stream of the database itself, right? And that again was, at that time was unique. So what we did was we started, we built systems, I'll talk about it in the next slide. We built a system called ASOP, which can listen into multiple bin logs for replications, right? So we could listen into MySQL, we could listen into HBase. So as patterns, if you see at one point we had sidecars, now change propagation became another pattern that on the stateful side we started to adopt and build systems around. So we had this and it was called tiered data store. We were running it, we built it on top of, so ASOP was built on, LinkedIn has this project called Databus. I don't know if you guys know. So we built it on top of Databus, built support for a whole lot of upstream and downstream data sources. Like we could listen to HBase, we could listen into MySQL, populate Redis, populate Elasticsearch, so which means that a typical search data store, data can be just seamless, in a streaming fashion, be constantly getting indexed even as they're getting created, right? Instead of doing a typical ETL kind of a thing. Catalog. So this is kind of a interesting use case because in our catalog today, when we have, again, you know, millions of products, we sell a diaper, we sell an iPhone, right? Now try to do data modeling for that. What will be your attributes? Name, title, make, model for a diaper? No. Variant? No. Screen? No. So then what will your schema look like? It becomes a fairly interesting problem, right? So we started off with something like what is called as an entity attribute value, which is very, very sparse distribution of this. And there was no way that service could have scaled to, let's say, 5 million reads per second, do what you want to do, right? So this example, so if you have a catalog data and then you're trying to get, again, cuts of that data, right? In a website, you're trying to show more information. In a cart, you're just showing very minuscule portion of information. Now, do you serve the same data across, right? So that's a problem. So what we did was we said, okay, now let's look at how this can be solved, right? And the fastest way you can scale, serve all this data is through cache from memory, right? Not cache, but from memory. And if you take a conventional approach of saying to store all of this data and to serve it at scale, we wanted a network load balancer which can serve 190 Gbps network bandwidth. Not happening, right, with that kind of a bandwidth. So we went with an approach of saying, can we create smart clients where the smart client is now data aware and the data is now replicated and kept in memory across a whole cluster of machines. Now, the thing with about replication and keeping in memory is not all our products are equally important or see equal traffic at any point in time. If you say a flash sale, you'll probably see that particular product retrieved millions of times, where something else, which is like a phone case and cover, may not even see a single QPS. Right? Then how do you equally replicate all of this data across your whole cluster and keep it in memory? Right? So because your memory is, you can at max finally limits where saying we could get 50 GB of memory on each box. Right? But what you need is 500 GB. Now what do you do with what's kept in memory? So we built a selective replication mechanism called V-buckets, where we could say, hey, this product is in this V-bucket, and this V-bucket is replicated 20 times versus this is just replicated one time, right? And all of this information is available at the client side, so any client calling the catalog service will know exactly which node to hit. So also remove the whole, the load balancer from the whole data path, right? So that's how today catalog as a service scales. Every year, the QPS just keeps going up. But it's once you have solved this, it becomes an easier problem. You just need to have more number of replicas of the data so you can actually get to 5 million, gets even to 11 million QPS, and it still works. Yeah, and in this, another pattern which we solved for was the CQRS, which is our entire write path is different from the read path. Okay, so the write path, when you're trying to ingest, is at very high QPS of writes. So imagine if you have to have we need a data store which can give very high volume of writes and high volume of reads, right? Now, high volume of reads, we know that conventionally databases which are built on LSM trees work well, right? Because they're typically append only stores. So our write store in catalog is actually HBase, while the read store, the custom one which I told about, all those replica placement, runs on top of a Redis cluster and orchestrated around it, right? So essentially, it is a path where the whole CQRS as a pattern is implemented. Another story of use case, which is around, let's say if you see this is shopping cart, right? So shopping cart, what item you see there, you need strong consistency because you want the item has to be in stock, it has to show the current price, it has to show whether it is added to cart or not, right? And this is, if you see the read-write ratios, again, it's 2:1, and throughput is around, you're talking about, say, 100K QPS for a shopping cart. Checkout, again, similar requirements, add another 100K QPS on top of that, right? Then comes, let's say, orders, which is adding read-write ratios are, it's 10 times more read than number of times it's written, right? So that is right, you're talking about saying again 120 kqps, and if you go by the typical CAP classification, these are CP store, right? Again, we started with, if you look at the DB, we started with all of this on MySQL, had problems with scale, went to NDB, which is a distributed MySQL, didn't work. Then we went with VoltDB, which was a commercial offering, again, didn't work. And we actually had a mix of all these, right? So we had HBase for something, we had MongoDB, we had MySQL, we had VoltDB, Redis, and just transaction funnel was so many databases, right? So from there, what we did was we, again, built a custom solution on top of HBase. So today it's called Yark, nothing creative, yet another key store, though it's not a key value store. What we did with this was we wanted better data manageability, right? So with HBase, so those of you who use HBase, you know that if you store data, it splits it by the range, sorted by the keys, and then it will go and store it in any of the region servers where the table is hosted. Table? Yeah, wherever it's hosted, right? Now, the problem we had was if we store in this way, and let's say we solve for scale, what happens if one region server goes down, right? You could lose data from cart, checkout, order. If there is replica, of course there is replica, but what data you lost or became unavailable there was we started losing data for across a mix of our domains, right? And also in terms of replication, if you set the replication factor, it will pretty much become that all of them get replicated equal. So we took a feature which was there in HBase 2 and backported it back to HBase 1, and this was RS groups. And with RS groups, what we could do was we could pin data to specific region servers. So there were region servers which are hosting only card data. Same HBase cluster, but they were hosting only card data, order data, and so on, right? And there were, so we could that way create many logical clusters, and we could take calls around saying, okay, let's over replicate order data as opposed to, let's say, card data, for example, right? And led to a consolidation across all those data stores to now pretty much all of card checkout, all of your financial, even all your payments, everything now runs on top of Yark. Right? So there is those of you who are more interested, there is another video I can point you to that you can even talk about, go through RS groups and how we did with this. Then what we also had was typical use case, the same data which was there in our order database had to be available for a bunch of downstream systems, right? So we, if you remember, we started with change data capture, so that knowledge we applied, implemented CDC, which could push data to Kafka from an Elasticsearch, to be eventually consumed by Elasticsearch and so on, from this Yark cluster, so that the data could go to downstream, eventually consistent systems through our CDC mechanism. The other problem we had was indexes. Right, HBase, those of us who used, you know that it is famous for not supporting, secondary indexes are supported, performant secondary indexes are a problem, right? So now how do you deal with secondary indexes? One way is, you can create another index table and use coprocessors to insert that data into those index tables, right? But the problem with coprocessors is it's async, so you can never get read or write consistency on if you search using the secondary indexes. So essentially what we did was at the layer that we wrote on above, we actually write to two stores, which is the index store and the first to the index store and then the data table. Now the problem with that is if the write to the data table fails, you have unreachable tombstones, right? You can find an index, but you'll probably not find data. So that then gets reconciled either during read time or through an offline process, right? So in summary, that was, for us, it was about taking something that's out there, like HBase, and building a bunch of things around it, custom to kind of satisfy both the consistency needs and the kind of scaling needs and data manageability that we had for these data sets. Okay, so from there, this is more of a current problem. Now, most of all the tech stack that I said, right? If you say even Yark, you talk about user service. So we use user service is still, user data still sits on MySQL, but we use Vitus for MySQL sharding. Vitus is, if you know, it's It was built by YouTube guys from Google. They built it for MySQL sharding, right? So we contributed back to that. We wrote a JDBC driver on top of Vitus. So most of our user data sits on top of that. But still this data and all of these data are single DC, right? So if I say orders, a user places an order in DC1, the DC goes down, you fail him over to the other DC. You can still set up HBase cluster replication, but then now instead of two DCs, let's make it three. Right? Then what do you have as a problem? Is like, how do you replicate data across all of these and still try to keep them consistent, right? Other interesting use cases are things like a flash sale. So where we are, very high velocity decrement of counters that are there. How do you allow a flash sale to be served out of multiple data centers where users are coming and trying to buy the very same product, right? And why we want to do this is, see, one option is we can say we have active passive. But the moment you go active passive, to give you perspective, to have a passive data center is like $100 million worth of hardware. So you just can't afford to have that, right? So what ideal state would be is to have active data centers and split or serve your users simultaneously from across those things. So that's something that we're working on. And along the thing, if you see our investments that have gone into our data stores, we also now need to see how you can make it work across data centers, right? How can you have synchronous replication of MySQL across three data centers for our user store? How do you do synchronous replication for Yak across three data stores? And like our inventory sits on Redis. Well, Redis is a cache, but we actually made it like a data store and make it work for holding inventory, right? And also have multiple consistency levels of what is strongly consistent, eventually consistent. And of course, all the other parameters of low latency, high throughput, and so on. And of course, no data loss that you want to have. So we have embarked on using distributed consensus mechanisms. So those of you have heard of protocols like Paxos. Raft, fortunately, is more understandable. So we are currently building data replication mechanisms using Raft so that we can have consistent writes across multiple data centers when a write is happening to a single item, right? So the idea is something like this. I change a password. We take the hit at the time of write time to replicate it consistently across multiple data centers and then acknowledge the write. So that if there is a failure and the user, you fail him over to another DC, the data is still available, right? But there can still be, even with mechanism like Raft, the problem is you're guaranteed consistency only if you go to the leader, the Raft leader. So we would now kind of pin users to a DC. So which means that if you interact with Flipkart, we direct you to a DC, pretty much all of your data is fulfilled locally. And then when we do a failover, it has to be a full mass failover for, let's say, 50% of the traffic and so on. And then deal with any consistency gaps at that point in time. But with consensus-based writes, you should not have a problem of consistency across DCs. The way we kind of approach this, see, our underlying stores are different data stores, so can we use Raft and build a data store with a pluggable storage, right? So we can still have locally MySQL HBase, but with Raft orchestrating the writes across multiple data centers. So we built some libraries, Nexus, which is one, which is again work in progress. We have also now started working on our own durable key value store that can be distributed across data centers and offer tunable consistency, right? So that is DKV, which is, non-imaginative name, which is just distributed key value. We're building it as open source, but the idea being we can build one hosted service which can serve all our key value serving needs and make it work across DCs, right? Like the catalog service, our inventory decrement, it could be our pricing service, our offer service, all of which today run on a combination of Redis, Aerospike, and so on, and can we make it work on a single DB? So that's work in progress. Even after using mechanisms like Raft, we still expect that data can go out of sync, and then have reconciliation mechanisms using techniques like Merkle trees, find ways to actually compare data copies across replicas and make them consistent. Now, techniques like this is not something that we are doing for the first time, and thankfully today people are talking more openly about it. Like Merkle trees first came to a notice when you're reading about DynamoDB, right? Years back, they used Merkle trees at that point in time to do data reconciliation. More recently, if you see CockroachDB, if you guys know, so Cockroach also talks, it uses RocksDB underneath, it uses Raft for consensus, but they also have ways for doing this data reconciliation, right? And over the years, again, folks like Google, when they build Spanner and they talk about true time and taking the cost of cost at the time of write versus at the time of read. So all of this is actually gives us a lot more ideas to experiment, right? Will we be successful? Only time will say, to see whether we can truly make these services multi-homed. What we'll also need in terms of hardware, we realized is, you're now doing all of this Raft writes across DCs. Now you're using the same network pipe, and on the same network pipe, even your big analytical data Hadoop replication is also going, right? So then you start having problem about one replication or choking the other, right? So now we're working with our networking team to see whether we can get different quality of service on the kind of network connectivity we have between nodes. So we can say that replication traffic will go on a less congested pipe. And how they do it is, let's say, whether they do packet level acceleration on the network, or will they give us a separate dedicated links. But at least for us to go and ask, saying that, look, I want replication traffic to go have much better SLAs and latencies across the DC. So at networking level, custom solutions. On the hardware level, so with public clouds and thing, of course, we'll all know that there is no guarantee to an instance coming up, right? So you're required to, if something fails, restore from another instance and move on. But for things like Raft, the problem is that Raft log is the source of truth. So at least those machines need to have storage which is raided, can be mounted from the network onto another instance and essentially not lose data. Unlike probably losing a MySQL slave. You can say that, okay, bring up another slave and replicate. So we're talking also about hardware, additional hardware requirements that will go into enabling this. So that's what I had, but to give you it's a whole journey across a whole wide spectrum of things. And like I said, without this, I couldn't have gone into scaling. It was not just about one system, right? The easiest would have been, okay, we scaled our front-end load balancer. No, that wouldn't have been enough. API layer, no, then data stores. So the whole journey is across the whole stack. So I wanted to kind of paint this broader picture and then have more detailed conversations with any of the ones that might be of interest to you guys.